Today, I'm going to cover, in previous lectures, we covered voice synthesis, where the computer actually talks to you, it actually says stuff to you, synthesizes it. This one's going to be recognition, where it recognizes what you say. So in other words, you can talk to the computer, and what it does is it takes whatever you say and converts it into a text string. So in other words, that's the proof that it knows what you're saying. So the way the first programs work, I always work with this thing is, if you say something to the computer, you don't know if it understood what you said or not. It might have thought you said something and you said something else. So what I always do with these programs is, the ones that we talk to the computer, I always put a little block of text up there, and you say something to it, and it converts it into text, and I put that text on the screen so you can see yourself if it understood what you said. It's like a confirmation. And if you don't do that, you could be thinking it's listening to what you're saying, and it could be interpreted completely differently. It's quite astounding, really, that they can actually take sound and then convert it into text so clearly, do it very well, very rapidly, too. So I'm quite impressed with this. But there are some downsides to this program, to this activity, which is different than all the other things we've done. Google actually wrote this for commercial purposes. And what they did was, before they put it onto their, before they even had their cell phone operating system, they were building this sound thing that, so you can communicate back and forth. And the problem is that they don't let you lock up their system by doing it forever. For example, you can't write a program and have it keep listening to what you say for an hour. It won't do it. It'll only do it for a few minutes. It cuts you off pretty quickly. Now, there is a way of doing it permanently, and basically here's what they decided. There's a thing called Secure Socket Layer, SSL. It's something that we don't have available on our host site. It's something you usually have to pay for. It's a secondary check of some kind on what you're doing. And what it does is it kind of ensures a little bit that people are not eavesdropping. See, if this thing can listen to what you say and write the text, somebody could use that to eavesdrop on your computer. Just listen to what you're saying or watch you and just do that. So Google got nervous about that. They said, oh, we don't want to have that happen. So what they said was, we'll turn this thing on for a secure socket layer. That way we'll know who's doing it. We'll know where it's locked down to. And so basically they'll be able to immediately identify if anyone's doing anything bad. They'll be able to find out who it is right away. So what it comes down to is this. The thing I'm going to show you is you can do it if you have your own site. You can get a secure socket layer. They usually don't cost very much, but you can add that to your site. They add that to the site. And then it will give you the ability to use this thing on a permanent basis. You can actually use it for a much longer period of time. So basically, this is sort of like a demonstration. We can do it, but we can't do it as if, you know, you couldn't have it say a whole paragraph and another paragraph. It wouldn't do that. It wouldn't allow you to say that much. It only allows you to say little bursts of things. And then it tells you what you said. Okay, so essentially what happens is, like with all these things that you don't want to have to write the code for, there's an include file. There's a little file you have to put in at the beginning, which actually does all the work for us. It's Google, a Google program. It's my program that talks to the Google program, so they're sort of up there. And I'm going to write that line of code out because it's a very long line. And then I'll write the program and show you how to use this thing. So the first program I'm going to write is going to simply do this. It's going to say, when the program runs, I'm going to say, hello, my name is Joe, and it's going to say, hello, my name is Joe. This is what I'm saying today. It'll say, this is what I'm saying today. Now, whatever I say, it'll simply put it on the screen. It's kind of a simple idea, but it shows you that it can capture the verbal sound and convert it into text. So it kind of knows what you're saying. So let me write the first part of it. And this part right here is the part that's you've got to be careful about. I got HTML. And I'm only writing them like this because I write it vertically, except we don't have a blackboard, whiteboard here, so I do that. Okay, the first thing is, this is the script. You need this script, okay? And don't forget, you have to write these things pretty much, you gotta be very careful about them. It has to have the right punctuation. Everything has to be exactly right. Like I say about programs, they're like one giant password. You make a mistake, it don't work. So this one here, what you say is type equals, these are online by the way too, text, text slash JavaScript. I'll talk again in both of a second. http://. That's a slash right here. Okay. Pretty long, isn't it? It's a really, really long thing. We won't be having to write as long things as this in the next couple of weeks. I'll show you how to do it shorter. Here's what happens here. I have a file on my account here. I have this file, and it does a lot of programs stuff for you. Okay. In this case, this one right here just simply says whatever you hear, convert it into text and send it back to the user. That's all this thing does. So no, it's a special program that does that. So now the question is, you as the user, question.
What does it say after listen?
Where?
Listen dot what?
JS, JavaScript. Okay. It's JavaScript.
Okay.
And just make sure we do the quotation at the end after JS. I was making sure you're right.
It's supposed to be a quotation. No, right here. Thank you very much. That would fail. In fact, that's exactly what a couple of students did this time, that quote mark. Yeah, you gotta be really careful of that stuff, right? So thank you very much. These things are so delicate. Occasionally I'll have a student write something that's completely wrong, but it works. I don't know why. There's some variation in what they accept. Somebody put like a semicolon back there and it worked. I don't know why it worked, but it worked. It's really weird. Anyway, so this is the way it should be written though. This is the exact way. That's not an X, by the way. This right here is like, it's like this, one of these things with a slash right there. Not an X. Can you read that okay? It is online. These programs are online, so you can actually look at them clearly and see what they look like. Okay, so that first thing is, now this program, when you put this into your program, it immediately starts to listen when the program runs. You don't have to do anything. It starts to listen to you right away. Except for the fact that it says to you, do you want to turn on your microphone? You have to say, yes, I want to turn on my microphone. That's the security part. And once you say, I want to turn on my microphone, it's now listening to you, and it's ready to write down anything you say. Okay, so that's the part that you have to put in for that. Now I'm going to write the JavaScript code right here. There's not much down in the body because you don't have to do very much in the body. Because all you're doing here is when the program runs and you start talking, it starts to operate. But you got to have a place, you got to put a little block of where the output's going to go. You have to tell it where the output goes. And that's the only thing you have to put in the body. But let me do the program here. So I'm going to say script language equals JavaScript. That's the usual. It just simply says we're going to write code in here. And I'm going to write the function. Now, this is a special function. It has to have this name, no other name. The function here is listen. It has to have that name. And here's the reason why. Because I've written this program up here in such a way that what happens is you say something, it converts it into text, and then it sends that text back to the function listen. That's where it sends it to. So instead of you writing something to listen, it's talking to listen, but you have to write this function out clearly right here. Okay, function listen. And then what happens is, let me write this line and I'll tell you what it means. Call it my words. This is just a variable I made. That's just my variable right there. Equals transcription. Now, and then I'll just finish it off. I'll say out1.value equals my words. I'll explain how this works in a second here. And that closes that. Okay. So here's basically how the program kind of works. You say, hi, my name is Joe. It goes into the, so you got to have your microphone. It goes in the microphone. It goes up to this program and it converts it into text. It does that over in Google's, one of the Google. It goes up online and it goes out there and does it and comes back. It's very, very fast. So it's like a Google search. It's very fast. The words come back. And then what happens is it says, go to listen. And it goes to listen. And it brings back this thing right here, which is a variable. Transcription contains the actual text. You said the words, and it comes back to you as the variable transcription. That contains the words you said. So it's just like you have a variable with the words you said in it. Now, the thing is, you don't want to do anything to transcription. You don't want to glue it to anything or do anything to it, because here's what Google does. Supposing I said, my name is Joe. The first attempt at it might be, my main is Joe or something. They'll get it wrong right away. And then it'll go through all of the billions of people and it'll finally get it right. And then it'll send it to you in the correct way. The trouble is that what they're doing is they're changing the word transcription. They're changing the value of it. Now, if you try to do something to it while they're doing something to it at the same time, it causes a lot of trouble. So we don't want that to happen. So what I do is I say when they send you the first transcription, just move it over to your own variable. Then you can do whatever you want with it. It's not going to interfere. But do not do any action. This is the only way you should say transcription equals something. That should be it. Transcription's over. Don't even talk about it anymore. Okay? Forget about it. So remember, it sends the answer to here in this variable. So now you've created the listen, it comes in, now you have transcription, and you send it to my words, and you say my words equals all. You're basically putting it on the screen for the user to see what's going on. Okay? So what happens is you talk it, it shows it to you. You talk it, it shows it to you. That's how it works. Let me write the rest of the program. So then you have slash script here, slash head. I'll just put body. I'll make this simple. Make it a simple program. Nothing there except these three things are done. And now what you have to do is you have to have this location right here. So you have input. And ID equals out1. And type equals text. In the program that you're going to see that I wrote online, I actually created a longer line so in case you said a long sentence, it'll have it all there. And also I made the letters bigger. I made it larger. So basically I put a style sheet in this, but there's no point in doing that. The style sheet simply says make tall letters and make the line longer. That's all it says, the width of it. But you'll see that it's the same stuff we do. Width is controlled by width. And the height of the letters was, I think I made them like, well, let's see what we got here. I mean, a 35-point font is very tall. It's a big font. So you're going to see it's going to come off on the screen very big. So here's what your that's right there. Let me just finish this off. Slash body. Slash HTML. Now, in previous, if you go back to any of my previous classes where we've done stuff like this, I've added another line in here. And what that line does is, if this thing goes to sleep, I got a wake-up line. You press the wake-up line, it wakes up again. But it turns out that doesn't work anymore for some reason. They must have done something, made a change. So I said, why put that there? If this thing goes to sleep on you, it doesn't hear what you're saying anymore, just reach up to the arrow in the browser and hit that. it'll get it going again, okay? That's the only way you can get it recharged if it's, it dies on you. Okay, so that should be the whole program. Let me see if everything's there. I believe it is. This is the critical part. It goes to listen, transcription, my words, alt one, value, alt one, blah, blah. There it is. That's the entire program. So what the program looks like is something like this. It's got a big block here. And when you say blah, 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 it just writes it right in this, that just writes it right in space. That's all it does. It might not know it. Yeah, I would know the word blah. There's some words it doesn't know. Names are particularly interesting. It can almost catch some of them, but if you have a really complicated name, it has a hard time with that. But believe it or not, it actually has a whole list of names. There's a lot of complicated names it does know, and it's able to do. So there it is. That program will allow you to talk to it, and you can actually say stuff to it, and it understands what you say. Now, when you do this, when you write this program, it's interesting to have a program that says, hello, my name is Joe, and all that kind of stuff, and it puts it on the screen. But a lot of times, you might want to do something different. Do you remember the program we wrote last time about tall and short? We said, are you tall or are you short? And then we tested that. We said, are you tall or are you short? And then we said, you are tall or you are short. You can do the same thing with the verbal stuff. It's exactly the same. Because once this thing converts it into text, you can look at that text to see if it said tall or short, see if it's in there. So you can actually, they say something, but you can actually see it and do a test on it to see if they said the words you're looking for. So let's supposing, let's change this program here. Let's supposing it's got a different thing. Supposing it's just showing you, it's still going to have to do that. It's still going to have to show you what it said. Where did I do that? Right here. It's still going to show you what you said. Out one equals value right there. But now what I want to do is, I'm going to ask it a question. Well, let me write the question first. I should have a question here. Are you tall or short? Now it's going to ask that question. Are you tall or short? That's all it asks. And it gives you, you say the answer. I should say, to not be confusing, because you don't want them to type it in. I don't know how you read it. How old do you think you read it? So basically what I'm saying is, verbally tell me if you're tall or short. Say that to me. And so they'll say it. They'll say it some, I am tall, I am short, short, tall, whatever. Whatever they say. So now the question is, down in here, I have to have another spot. This is out one here. That's just what they say. That's what you say to the program. And this one right here is the answer. It says, you said you were tall, or you said you were short. So you're going to have a different place for an answer down here. So I'm going to add another one right here. This is where, if you are tall, it's going to say you are tall. If you're short, it's going to say you are short. So you're going to have this input right here. ID, I'll call it out 2, just to keep it different. 2. And type is text also. There it is. Okay, then slash body, slash HTML. There it is. Okay. Now the question is, what do I do in the program here to make this work? Okay, I need to do a few other things. I'm actually going to write this smaller so I can get it all in, but I want to put it all back in again. So again, you still have a listen. Listen's still there. And still you have transcription, because whatever you say is going to be brought to transcription. But the first thing you want to do is you want to put it up here so at least the user can see what they said. And then this thing here is going to analyze what they said and tell them this is what they said. It's going to say, you are tall or you are short. Okay? So let me just try to get all this in here. Okay, first thing I want to do is I want to get the transcription. So I say variable my words equals transcription. Don't forget, that's a magic word there. Has to always be the same. Scription. It's a long word. I should have made it shorter, I think. Anyway, transcription. So now my words contain transcription. The first thing you want to do is you want to put it up where vla is. So you say out one, just like we had before, dot value equals my words. All that does is be sure that the user sees what they said, so they'll know they said the right thing. That's the same as we had in the previous program. Okay, now, next question is, you want to find out if they said tall or short. So what you do is, you create a variable, and I called it POST last time, we call it the same thing. What position is, in my words, index of, it's a big F, that's a big O right there, index of, and I want to find the word tall. There. So in other words, when it hits this line right here, if within the words, it's in the text, it looks at the text and says, did they say the word tall in that text? And it marks this as zero or higher if they've actually seen it. So that means you have a hit. You actually saw the word tall. You also have to test for the word short. Position S equals my words dot index of short. There it is. So those are really the same line, except one has a test for short and one tests for tall. If post is zero or bigger, you had the word tall. If POSS is zero or larger, you're going to find the word short. So you say, well, if post is greater than or equal to zero, in other words, if it's equal to zero, or it's bigger than zero, it's a positive number, then what you want to do is you want to say out to dot value, which is where you're going to tell them right here. Where you're going to tell them you are tall or you are short equals, quote, you are tall. This is actually kind of silly, as you can see, but I mean, it's just an example, simple example, that's all. Then you have to ask if they say they're short. So you say if POSS is greater than or equal to zero, then what you say is out to dot value is equal to you are short. There it is. Then you close it right here. Right there. That's the close of it. So this is the end of the, it's the beginning is the end of the function. And so when you run this program, what's going to happen is if they say, I am tall, it's going to find the expression, I am tall. It's going to put it on the screen, up at blah. And then it's going to say, did you say the word tall in that? So it looks to see if there's an index for that word tall. And, or did you say short? It looks for the index of short. And if the index of tall shows you got a word, it says you said you're tall. If the index of short shows you we found that word, it says you were short. That's it. So now this is a simple version, but you can see the idea. Now what you have is a cool little machine that actually will allow you to say stuff to the computer, and it will look at what you say, and you can analyze what you say depending on what you're looking for. Okay? We used to have this program called LISA back when we didn't have hardly any computers at all. They were kind of weird. But what LISA would do, it was kind of a clever program. It would say, hello, and you type hello. And it would say, how are you, or something like that. And then it would say, what are you thinking about? And so if you wrote anything, any of the magic words it was looking for, and it was all this Freudian stuff, if you said the word mother or father or sister or brother or any familial things or anything like that, it would look for those words. And as soon as it found one of those words, it would say, well, what do you want to talk about your mother? What do you want to say about her? Or something like that. It would start a conversation, even though it didn't know anything of what you were doing. It just found the word mother, and it's trying to get you to talk. So you start typing stuff. And what it would do is it would keep looking for critical words, and it would say things like, well, tell me more about that, if it didn't find a critical word, and you keep typing, and finally it would find a word that it, you know, it liked. You know, if you said your father was mean or something, it would say, oh, your father is mean, well, how do you know that, or something. Then, in other words, it would just play you along. It didn't know anything about what you were saying, it just had certain words that it would build on. And that program became a big hit. I mean, it was only, I mean, code-wise, it was only about that long, you know, line by line. It wasn't a very big program, but actually, it could jerk you around quite badly. You could be sitting there for hours thinking, this thing know what I'm saying or doesn't it? Pretty soon you realize it doesn't know anything, but it took a while. But they started that stuff right off in the beginning. Even though you couldn't talk to it, you could type to it, and it already began having discourse between the person and the machine. Anyway, there you have it. It's a this program, I have it online also. There's another program. Okay, there's some other things I want to show you that don't really fit into what we're doing. There's always these little side, one question.
I'm sorry, the if line where you are short,
yes, down here.
Is it equal to, are there, it looks like both the tall and the short show,
this is POSS,
uh-huh.
It's POST.
Okay, gotcha.
Yeah. They're very well. I use the word POS for position all the time.
Okay.
So then I just throw in a letter to make it, you know, personalize it or something. Post is actually, I would think, is a dangerous word, to tell you the truth. They could say, you know, you post things online, so it's possibly, yeah, that it could be, but it didn't conflict. I ran it, didn't conflict. I was kind of surprised. Sometimes it's forgiving. You never know what it's going to do. Anyway, so that program's online, and you can run it. You can actually, the program's there. I also describe it online, but I run it. You can run it, and you can copy it. You can copy the program, bring it into your machine, change what it's asking for. You can do all kinds of stuff with it. And that's part of what I want to talk about today, is how to do that kind of thing. Sometimes when you go to a website, like our website, you're going to see programs that you want pieces of. You want a piece of that program, okay? Like Robert De Niro, you want a piece of it. So you want to take a piece of this program and you want to bring it into your own program. Let me show you how to do that. It's really not very hard to do, but it all depends on the clipboard. Everything's with the clipboard. Everything involves a clipboard. But can I get rid of that? Anybody have any questions about that? Okay. I think someone upstairs is doing dentistry or something. Guy's got a bad tooth. Okay. Supposing you go to my website and you find a program that, like for example, you're in the in our website, and you open up a program and you run it. You say, yeah, this program has the stuff I want in it. And you want to get the code. You want to get to the code and get it out. Okay. The first thing is, there's several ways of getting to the code, and it all depends on what the program does. And that's nothing I can do about that. You have to figure out. What you do is, step number one, if you have the program in front of you, like the program's here, and it says stuff to you, and it's got inputs and all that kind of stuff, and you want to see what made that happen, okay, hold down the control, and hit the letter U. Control U, and then it will show you the code that made that, maybe. You hope it will, but it may not. Okay? So the question is, what do you do if it doesn't do that for you? You can't get it to do that. Okay. Okay, so what you do is, you do that, it doesn't work. Next step, this is what I would do immediately if I were you. There's three dots up there in the corner in your browser. Open that browser, and you're going to see this. You're going to see minus 100 plus, like that, okay? Hit that minus sign, which shrinks this thing like that. It'll shrink it down to here, and there'll be white space out there. That white space is the magic space. Then you can do a control U out there, and it'll probably work, okay? That's the easiest way out. And the thing is, when you try to do it within the program, the program sometimes captures the commands and it doesn't let you do it. But if you do it out here, you've escaped from the program's control. You're out here, out in the browser, but you're not in the program anymore. So that kind of works, okay? If you do that, what you're going to see then is the actual code lines that made this program. You're going to see this, right? That's what's going to be in front of you. Instead of the program, you're going to see the code lines, okay? Now the question is, if you like that code and you want to get part of it or all of it down to your machine, how do you do it? Step number one is select it. Select the code. There's different ways of doing it. If you just left mouse over and drag across, it'll all turn blue. You can go up here and you say select all. You can do that from a command line. There's different ways of doing it. However, you're probably used to doing it. Just select the whole thing. Be sure you get everything though. If there's any little part missing down here, it'll screw you up. You've got to get everything from top to bottom. Select the whole thing so it's blue. And do a control C. And what that'll do is it'll copy it. So you selected it, then you copy it. Okay. Now you have it on your clipboard. This program is now on your clipboard. The next thing you do is you want to put it in your machine. So you go to Notepad, open up a note, open Notepad, okay, open a blank Notepad. Like so. And then what you do is Control V. Or paste it in. You paste the whole thing in. So that whole program will now go into that. The whole program you copied will now go into your local machine's Notepad. And then what you do is you save it. You know, save it as an HTML. Just like you would save any HTML program. And now you have it. Now, you have the program, but the program doesn't call for anything else. If it doesn't call for any kind of pictures, if it has pictures and stuff like that, you got to do the same thing. And I'll show you how to do that in a second. Basically, if there's no pictures, you now have the program, you should be able to run it, and it should be fine. It should run in your machine, okay? So it's all in your machine now, it's not online anymore. But supposing it has a picture, supposing it has a JPEG picture out here, and that's part of the program, you want that too. So what you do is, when you do the Control U, when you see this thing listed over here, you'll see this JPEG over here, and it'll be colored blue, a blue color, different than everything else. If you just tap on that thing, thunk, like so, the picture will come up. You'll see the picture. There it is. The picture's there. Okay? Very simple. Then what you can do is you can right-click on the thing, and save that. And save that in your same folder, the CS101 folder that you're saving this in. Bring it, no, when you right-click on it, it says copy. You can copy it. And then you can say save as and bring it into your, or it might even say right click might give you ability to say save as. And then you bring it into your CS101 folder and save it so that this program and that picture will both be in the CS101 folder. Then the program will work. If that's the only external thing that it had, was just this JPEG, you can now run it. And that's kind of a handy thing to have because on my site there are dozens of programs with nice little pieces of things. You might just want to pull, you know, you might just want to pull a part of it, just this piece right here, just select that piece. I do control copy, and it will copy just that piece for you, and you can bring it down, drop it into your program. It's very handy to be able to do that. This is probably the only course you'll ever take where it teaches you how to steal stuff. That's it. But don't tell anybody. We're not stealing. We're just using it for educational purposes. So basically, that's what you want to do. You want to take code and use it in your local machine. Now, there's another thing that I have to mention along the same lines, which is a slightly more complicated idea. Do you remember that big long thing I wrote up here? Blah, 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 .works.com/listener and all that stuff, okay? That's what you normally have to write into your program to access that include file. That include file contains a lot of code you want. And it's located on my site, or in the .works site. So here it is up here. I think it's called listener. JavaScript up there. So it's up there on my site up there, the .works.blah-blah-blah. Well, the thing is that if you want listener, suppose you want to get it, you want to get listener, what you do is you go to the .works site and you say .works.com/listener.js, just like you know, it says .works.com, same as you always do. Oh, no, you don't. .com. This time, just pull up the file listener. And here's what happens. When you type that, probably HTTP and all that should be out here too, but .works.com listener, what will happen is, the listener, the actual code for this thing will come up in front of you. It'll all be kind of weird. It won't look like anything you've ever seen before. But don't worry about that. You don't care about that. Here's what we want to do. I want to set it up so that when you write your program, you don't have to write http.works, blah, blah, blah. All you have to do is write listener, and it will give you what you want. In other words, this include file could be just called by its name. So here's what you do. When you click on this right here, this will come up. Select the whole thing. Select it all. And then go back down to Notepad and paste it in, just like we did over here, paste it in, and then save it, only give it the name, exactly the same name as that, listener.js, and you also have to do all files. You also have to do all files. And now you will have, in your CS101 folder, you have listener, which is used by this program. Okay, you want to use this, you want to take advantage of it. So now what happens is when you write your program, you no longer have to write that great big line of code. Here's what you write. You say, okay, script type equals text slash JavaScript. You say source equals listener. You get rid of all the dot work stuff. There it is. That's the whole line. See, all that stuff that was in front of that, the .works.com and all that, you don't need it anymore. Because now what you're doing is you're calling listener, which is in your CS101 folder. It's got its own place now. It's in your machine as well. See, previously I had it written with the .works and all that stuff simply because I didn't want you to get through the complications of trying to download something and do all that stuff. But at this point, it shouldn't be hard for you to do. Basically, you go to listener.js just like this. It'll show you the code immediately, select it all, open up a notepad, paste it in, save it, and give it that name right there, right in your CS101 folder. And from then on, this is what you would write for a listener. That's .js, by the way. You just write that. You wouldn't write .works.com and all that stuff. Question, you have a question in the back?
I was just making sure that you wanted us to copy-paste everything that was on .works.com/listener.js. And copy paste that onto a notepad, all of.
Wait a minute. This line right here? The original one? Or this thing right here?
Yeah.
Oh, this thing. Oh, would you? Okay, let me just do one more time. Tell me if I missed it.
Sorry. Yeah.
You got it? Okay, you're all set?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Anybody else have a question about that, how to do that? So you see, there is a little advantage to doing this because now you can write this line here, which is a lot shorter than the other one. If you don't care about that, if you don't want to put listener in your own folder, you don't have to. You can use the one that's on my site. Just by putting in front of this, http://.works.com/this thing, and it works just as well. Okay, it might take an instant of time, fast and slower to get it, but nothing you'd notice. So that's a kind of a handy thing to know how to do, because that way your programs won't have these great big long lines. Because the longer the line, the more likely there is a typo. Because I do it on the board every day, so you can see it's just a lot of stuff. Every single thing counts too. But there's a possibility for you if you want to do that. Okay, so now, next thing is, there are things that are not actually related to programming directly, but they're important to us. There are things that context kinds of stuff. So when you have a program, let's make a JavaScript, a simple JavaScript program. So when you have a function, we'll call it blah. I'm into blah today. And we say variable a equals 4 and variable b equals 4 times 3. And end of function. That's all there is to it. It's just the function. It makes a 4 and makes 4 times 3. Doesn't do anything else. Okay. Suppose we run this program and we discover it doesn't work. And we wonder, one of these lines was not written correctly. Supposing I forgot to put this out here, or something happened, the line didn't run right. And the question was, you know the program doesn't work, but you don't know which line, you look at it and you can't seem to get which line is not working. Okay, if in front of the line that you suspect, start off with the line you suspect, if you write two asterisks, two backward slashes like that, that kills that line. That line's not there anymore. You can see it, but it doesn't do anything. So the program will come down, it'll do the A equals 4, jump right over that, and it'll do this. That right there creates a situation where you can see the text that you wrote, but it won't, the program doesn't run it. Okay, and that's very handy to be able to do that. Another thing that you do with these double things, if you want, another thing you can do is you can say, these instructions, you can give blah, blah, blah. You know, as you can put two slashes, then you can write any words you want. And this is for your own consumption. The user will never see it. There's two worlds going on here. There's the world where you're writing code, and you have to keep track of what you're doing. And then there's the world where the user sees it. They see an entirely different thing. So sometimes you want to have words in your program that you can look at, say, like if you didn't look at the program for 3 years, you look at it and say, oh, yeah, I forgot about that. You can actually put those lines in and tell you those funny little things that you might forget. Okay, so you could write as many as you want too. You could write, you know, several lines or anything you want. That's one possibility. It's called a comment statement. C-O-M-M-E-N-T. That's what you're doing. Creating a comment. That's a comment. And it works in almost every language, by the way. There's two slashes are very universal. Okay, there's another thing you could do. Supposing you had a huge program that had really a lot of stuff in it. Yeah, you can go slash, 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 slash all the way down and shut the whole thing off, but you'd have to slash a bunch of things, and anytime you start typing, you're risking. The more you type, the more dangerous it becomes, because even the attempt to find something or fix something, you're going to make a mistake and the program goes crazy after that. So, here's what happens. Suppose I want to block out all of this text so that the program doesn't see it. I want to say, don't look at this text. You put one slash and an asterisk on top of it, above it, and then an asterisk and a slash below it. In other words, this goes above the code, this goes below the code, that code's invisible to the program, it won't run it at that point, okay? So that's very handy. Sometimes you have to do that. You have to cut out a big chunk of code and say, is this thing's in my way, what's going on here? So you shut it off, run the program without it, and so then it does something different. You say, oh, that was the problem. Then you can figure out in here somewhere there's a problem. Debugging a program is like a science unto itself. But as time goes on, I'll give you these little tools, and eventually you'll see these tools actually allow you to get to everything. You can figure out how stuff works. I haven't actually talked about debugging at all, so at this point you're sort of flying blind. You have to kind of look at now it's typo time is where you're working right now. Okay, so those two things I want you to know. And another thing. It turns out that HTML, if I was down in the body here, and I said, hello, and then I hit a bunch of spaces, bye, over here, I said that, when the program runs, it would show me hello, and bye, with one space. It wouldn't even see the other spaces. Because that's among the things it doesn't do. It doesn't see a big bunch of spaces. It's done to it. Okay, so, boy, they invented a character. Looks like this. Believe it or not, that is the space character in HTML. You have to write all those letters, but that will make one space in HTML. So if I put 20 of these things one after the other in between, right in between here and here, if I had a bunch of NTS, it would space it. It will space it for you. Okay? So that right there is a space. It's a very peculiar thing. They came up with it for whatever reason, but that's what they came up with. You have to use whatever they tell you, and that's what we have. So that creates spaces, and it's really quite a handy thing to I use it. If you want to see some other code, you can always, when you're on our main web page, if you hit Control-U, it'll show you all the code I'm using in the web page. So you can sort of see how it all lays out, why it does what it does. I did something Interesting, the last one, and I did it to show you this, and I should tell you about it now because I just plugged it in. I had a text line, an input line. Stuff, I don't know, whatever. I gave it some name, I don't know what it was. Type equals text. And what I did was, I said style equals quote text align center. Now you've seen this before. You've seen this in the body. In the body, if you say text align center, it aligns everything to the center of the page. Well, if you do it just in one input statement, it does something kind of interesting, because an input statement like looks like this normally, and when you type, normally it starts here and goes like so, whatever you type. But if you put text align center in there, the cursor sits right here, and when they start typing, the stuff goes this way and that way. It just fills in the space. It's kind of a nice way to type stuff in if you want to be sure that they're just typing everything in, okay? So that's a little trick I pulled, and I just want to show you. I stylized the input just in this one line, just in that one line, and stylized it, okay? Does that make sense to you? So that way, when they start typing, it'll type in the middle rather than on the left-hand side, left justified on the side. Okay, another thing is this. Over here, if you put the word autofocus, just that word, nothing around it at all, just that word, okay? What autofocus does is, it says that when the program begins, the cursor, the main cursor, the blue, the rectangle right there will be colored blue because it is now expecting you, whatever you type will go into that box. So in other words, what happens is, if you have several boxes in here, whatever, and this one has got the autofocus on it, what will happen is that will turn blue, and whatever you type will go into that space first, so you don't have to put your mouse in, it's already in there. So autofocus is kind of handy, okay? The next thing is, suppose you have three things to put in. You got this, and this other thing here, and so you're going to put three pieces of information in. You can't use returns. Don't use returns on anything. Type this in, and then hit a tab. It'll bounce it over to that. Then type in the next thing, hit a tab, it'll bounce it over that. Tabs move you across all different things. Supposing there's a button in the way, there's a button right here, okay? It'll stop there, but you don't want to type in there. If you hit a tab, it'll go to the button. Just hit the tab again, and it'll go to the next input place, wherever you want to input. So don't try to type into the button. Just keep watching the cursor, the blue cursor will move across. And that kind of gives you the ability to quickly type stuff in. But this is actually very handy when you first start off. But supposing you do some process, you do some arithmetic, you do some stuff, and then you want them to put some more information in the same places. Well, autofocus only does that the first time. It doesn't do it any other time. So what you have to do is, if you did a calculation, you went up to JavaScript, you did a calculation, then you came back, and you wanted it to be autofocused here again, here's how you do that. You're up in some function. You went up to a function, okay, whatever it is, and then what you do is you do your processing, and now you're going to give it back to them, but you want the autofocus to come back here again. What you do is, let's say this, the name of this area is N1. I'm going to call it N1. That's where you type in your thing. Up here you write N1, the name of whatever the name of that field is down below, dot focus, open, shut, semicolon, like that. And what that does is, that'll automatically, when it leaves this function, it'll drop the focus into here again. So they'll still be focused in that area. So for example, if you had a lot of things to type in, you type blah, 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 hit the button, and you can start typing again. It will be right back where you want it to be, and you can start typing again. So that actually pushes it. This can't be true. Okay. Do not pay attention. See how long you let it ring. Whoever it was just realized, oh, he's in class. Okay. So So that part right there. Let me see if anything else I want to be sure I cover here. These are these kind of little extra things that we haven't talked a lot about. Okay, I guess that pretty much is good for that. Now, at this point, let me kind of tell you where we're going here. What I wanted to do was, I wanted to give you some little bit of sound stuff for fun. That's kind of the fun stuff, talking and it talks back to you, or making sound, that's kind of fun stuff too. But a large percentage of what we're going to be doing is in the graphics area. So next week I'm going to start moving into graphics. I'm going to take, to do graphics, what you have to do is you have to control the mouse. You have to say, when the mouse grabs a hold of something, I got to be able to drag it around. Or if I click on something, I want to know I'm clicking on it. So in other words, you have to know what the mouse is doing all the time. And the second thing you have to know is, what is the keyboard doing? Like you might want to type stuff in, not just into a box, but you might want to hit the letter S, for example, for stop. And you want your program to stop under those circumstances. So you don't want to have to hit a button to get that stop in. You want the stop to go right into your program and do it, whatever it's going to do. Now here's where the problem comes in. This comes into a really big problem. You're in a browser over here, and the browser already knows things that these keys do. Remember we did command, we did the command U, for example. It already knows that stuff, and so when it sees it, it tries to do what it tries to do. Okay. So what happens if you're down here at the keyboard and you type one of those things that the browser knows, the browser will try to do what you told it to do. But if you're in a program, you don't want that to happen. What you want to do is, when you hit the letter S, you want it just to do what you want it to do, and you don't want it to default to the browser, start making the browser jump around to do something. So what you have to do when you're doing key stuff and mouse stuff, you have to capture these things so that the browser no longer sees them. You have to say, I want you to capture the mouse, whatever the mouse does, and whatever the keyboard does, and I do not want you to let the browser see it. Just hide it from them, okay? Then what happens is, whatever you want the mouse to do, whatever you want the browser, the keyboard to do, it will just do what you want to do. That's one possibility. The second possibility is to let the browser do what it wants to do later. In other words, you can do what you want to do, and then the browser will do what it wants to do with the same commands. That's very dangerous because you don't know what the browser is going to do with whatever you type in, so it's very dangerous. Here's where the trouble comes in, though. If you capture that, once you capture that mouse or capture that key, you can never depend on the browser to debug it. It won't do anything you want it to do after that. So if you want it to do anything, a command anything or anything, it just won't pay attention to it. And the trouble then, you start to say, what's wrong with my browser? There's nothing wrong with it. You've captured all the key commands and all the mouse, okay, and there's no way out. You're locked into the thing. So what we have to do in this class is, I have to give you full command so that you can control the mouse. The mouse can do anything you want it to do, and the browser and the keyboard can do anything you want it to do. And then we have to be aware of what the browser needs so that we'll know when to escape from that and when not to, okay? It's a little bit of a trick. And 99% of the time, we just stay in our program. We don't care about the browser. It should take care of itself. But occasionally you get in that situation where you have to let the browser, you hit a certain thing, you want the browser to do its thing. So I'll have to deal with that. But anyway, that's among the kind of problems we're going to deal with, because what I want to be able to do is, I want you to be able to grab stuff with the mouse and move it around, or click the mouse here, click the mouse there. I want you to be able to hit a key there and have something happen. So we're going to have objects on the screen. These objects are going to be, we're going to be able to move them around the screen, no matter if they're words or pictures or whatever they are, and we're going to be able to rotate them. We can rotate them this way, we can rotate them through the screen, we can rotate them that way, we rotate, do all kinds of stuff. And that's the next stage of the thing, is to give you the power to use that mouse. Now I'll tell you why. It's not just for fun. It's because when we get into 3D graphics, when we're in the 3D world, it's very important. That's the only thing you have to work with, is the mouse or talking to it or the keyboard. So those three things have to be at your disposal to say, I want this to happen, I want that to happen, and you have to have that power. So basically what I do it in HTML, which is a two-dimensional screen. We'll do everything in regular HTML. And then when we get to 3D, you'll already be completely familiar with what the mouse does. It requires one of these include files to make the mouse do its thing. And then you'll see how to use it. And then when you go to 3D, it'll be second nature to you. You'll be able to do it. At this point, what I'd like to do is just, I've covered pretty much everything I wanted to today. Let me just go to the videos, and if you guys want to leave, whatever you want, put the videos here.
Did it work? What did